Hello everyone, my name is Ashwant. I'm a second year PhD student from University of California, San Diego. Today I'll be presenting SparSDR, an architecture that significantly reduces the resources required for operation of a software-defined radio, especially the compute and backhaul requirements. This paper is co-written by Moin Kazrai, myself, and Sam Crow. We are advised by professors from UCSD and UIUC. Moin couldn't be here due to some travel restrictions, so I will be presenting on his behalf, but he'll be making some appearances in the slides ahead, so keep an eye out for him. Moving into the presentation, 30 years ago, software-defined radios were introduced as a universal and flexible radio platforms for transmitting and receiving signals over the air. The key idea behind their inception was that instead of using a dedicated receiver for communicating with each and every protocol, software-defined radios can be programmed to tune to any channel, capture a channel of any bandwidth, and decode any protocol. Even 30 years later, in the era of IoT and cloud computing, software-defined radios can still enable a lot of exciting applications. For example, they can act as a universal IoT gateway, or they can enable cloud sourcing the information from the spectrum using the residential backhaul available across US. So what makes them so flexible? Software-defined radios decouple the radio front end, which is responsible for capturing the signals from the spectrum, and the signal processing backend, which analyzes the signals and decodes the information bits. Having this decoupling makes the process flexible. For example, the radio front end can tune in and capture signals from any band. You can tune into an ISM band at 2.4 gigahertz or 900 megahertz, or figure out what is happening in aviation bands. Also, having flexible compute lets you decode any number of protocols. For example, you can decode Bluetooth, ZigBee, Wi-Fi, AM, FM, any number of them using the open source packages which are freely available in the internet. So what is the cost of this flexibility? The cost is that software-defined radios consume a lot of resources. Let's say you have a 100 megahertz USRP2, like that is a USRP2 that can capture 100 megahertz of spectrum. So as I said to you before, capturing this spectrum using SDR requires that radio front-end backhaul digital samples corresponding to this 100 megahertz spectrum via an Ethernet backhaul or a USB connection. But this requires almost 3.2 gigabits per second of constant backhaul. Unfortunately, such backhaul is not available in the existing software-defined radios. Most of them have only a gigabit Ethernet connection. So we have to cut down on the amount of spectrum we can capture from 100 megahertz to 25 megahertz, just so that we are able to pump the data through the backhaul without losing packets. Additionally, to interface or process these samples at such gigabits per second data rate, we need a server class processor. And as anyone who works with software-defined radio can tell you, we need like a bulky computer to process even say a Bluetooth capture. So for example, Bluetooth is like 1 megahertz wide and it has 1 Mbps of data, but it frequency hops across like 80 megahertz. In order to capture this data or sniff this data without actually connecting to the Bluetooth, we need to capture the whole bandwidth. So we are actually backhauling the gigabits of data, even though the actual information we are communicating is only megabits. So why is this happening? This is because software-defined radios capture the spectrum even when it is not occupied. So a more important question to ask is that like if not all the spectrum, how much spectrum should a software-defined radio backhaul? To get an estimate of that, we run a quick experiment where we compute the occupied bandwidth in megahertz in ISM band. Like we run this experiment for over 45 seconds. Like we captured the whole 125 megahertz for 45 seconds and plot the cumulative distribution function of the occupied bandwidth. As you can see, almost 40% of the time, there is no signal in the spectrum. And in this case, we do not need to send any data. Almost 85% of the time, only 18 megahertz out of 125 megahertz is occupied. And in this case, we need to send no more than 512 megabits per second. But what happens in existing SDRs? We constantly have to send 4 gigabits per second of data. So I'm telling you, backhaul and compute are the limiting factors in a SDR, and they are mostly wasted on sending noise samples. So how do we want to want the SDRs to operate? We want them to be sparsity proportional. That is, in simpler words, they should send data only when there is signal. Let's take a look at this example. This visualization is called spectrogram, and we are capturing spectrum at ISM unlicensed band, and x-axis represents frequency and y-axis represents time. Basically, what I'm saying is we just need the signal which is represented here in yellow, and we just need to ignore all the stuff in blue. That is, we don't need to send any data which is noise. Basically, I'm saying that we need to threshold it and send only the information bins, and only backhaul and compute on these active signals. SparSDR operates on this common sense and produces sparsity proportional backhaul and compute. So this is the existing data flow of the software-defined radio. And we implement our algorithms on two ends. One on front end, where we implement a sparsity proportional downsampling. That is, we intelligently choose backhaul the existing signals. And on the back end, where we process it so that we do not require too many resources. We implement the downsampling within the existing FPGAs without requiring any external hardware resources. And we downsample so much so that we require only a residential class backhaul to send the data to the signal processor. Additionally, the decoding on the other side is so lightweight that we can implement it on embedded processors. So what does it mean? What does it mean that we are able to do this modifications in the front end and the back end? It means that we can use just a Raspberry Pi to handle 100 megahertz of bandwidth, like to decode and analyze these signals in this bandwidth, provided of course there are not too many signals in the available in the spectrum. So let's first take a look at the front end. So as some of you might have guessed, the obvious thing to do is to represent the signal that is captured by the software-defined radio in frequency domain. So we do that. Like, we divide the signal into different intervals and apply Fourier transform. So, and in the Fourier transformed bins, we choose the bins which are active or which are high power, and so are the unused frequency bins. And we just backhaul these bins, backhaul what's left. So that's simple, right? I mean, nothing complicated. Is that enough to do? Basically, we do the same thing on the raw capture we have, and we see that the signal is leaking into the adjacent frequency bins. This is because FFT, just applying FFT spreads the signal. As you apply the FFT on a limited time interval, there is a leakage in frequency. This erases the gains we get from sparsity of the signal transmissions in the spectrum. So how do we, recover from this spreading? So there is a well-known technique in signal processing called windowing, where we do the same first step, like divide it into discrete intervals, but instead of directly computing the FFT, we apply a window. Basically, we multiply the samples with the windowed samples. I guess we can use Hanning window, Hamming window, anyone we want. And we tamper the signals at the window edges. This makes sure that the energy is focused on active bins. The reason why this is happening is the signal is slowly decaying as you move towards the edge of the window, and that is why you have a very compact representation of the signal in the frequency domain. So is that good enough? Remember that we don't just want to backhaul a compact representation of the signal. We also want to be able to reconstruct the signal in the backend. If we just take these bins and apply inverse of the Fourier transform, we recover the signal in the time domain. Basically the signal I show in the top, which is attenuated in the edges. That means we have lost a lot of signal information. So instead of just applying FFT on discrete time intervals, we do what is called as overlapping, so that even if the signal is attenuated in one window, it is highlighted in the next window. And so the overall signal can be recovered by just adding the overlapped windows in the backend. So what is the cost of windowing? Basically, we have to apply the same operation. We have to operate on the same sample in two windows simultaneously. This provides a 2x overhead in terms of the backhaul and also the processing on the backend. But we observed that this negation, it doesn't negate the huge gains we get from the sparsity of the spectrum. So we don't mind the overhead. So that's the front end. And until now, I have described how to downsample the data effectively. And now I will discuss back end. Basically, as I said to you before, to reconstruct the signal in the back end, we can just take the frequency means that of backhaul and apply inverse Fourier transform. Doing just this recovers the signal at its original sampling rate. That is, say if the ADC samples at 100 mega samples per second, the signal is also reconstructed at the same rate. But the problem of computing on this high sampling rate signal is still remains. So instead, why not do something simple? Instead of doing a full length FFT, why not take the bins that are backhaul and apply a partial FFT, partial IFFT. This reconstructs signal in time domain with fewer, with the lesser sampling rate. And additionally, operating on such lower sampling rate signal doesn't require any more than embedded processor. There is an additional detail in the implementation that we need an additional phase correction, which is deterministic. It is clearly explained in the paper, which you can take a look at. So now I have explained to you what are the algorithms we implement on the software-defined radio to enable sparsity-proportional backhaul and compute. Now I show how we can make existing radios, existing software-defined radios, sparsity-proportional. That is, how can we make or implement these algorithms on existing hardware? This data flow shows the sparse SDRs front end. As you can observe, we have replaced the lossy downsampling with our own block, which does the sparsity-proportional downsampling. If you have listened to the talk until now, you might have known that we need to do some processing. We just can't drop the samples and send it. We need to do windowing, we need to do an FFT, and we need to do a thresholding on top of the normal processing that happens in a software-defined radio. So this obviously requires certain hardware resources. Instead of using external hardware, we leverage the spare resources that are available in the FPGA. As you can see from this table, I have listed down the memory units called BRAMs and compute units called DSPs available in popular software-defined radio platforms. As you can see, we have some available. I guess the important question is, I'm just showing you the numbers, like what is the impact of that. So we have to figure out how much we can fit in the SDR, like what amount of compute can we fit into the SDR. So we figured that in N to 10, we were able to go until a maximum FFT length of 2048. In terms of frequency resolution, it's equals to 48.8 kilohertz. And in an AD Pluto, which is cheaper and has lesser resources, we were able to go until a maximum FFT length of 1024. This is because AD Pluto has lesser compute units that are, it has only 25 DSPs, which we have to make do with. So do we want to use higher FFT length or smaller FFT length? We did an empirical experiment where we found that, so this figure shows the percentage of backhaul bins that we have to backhaul in order to get a reconstruction error which is low. And as you can see, for the FFT size of 2048, our reconstruction error at the back end decreases significantly even though we backhaul only a small percentage of the bins. This is because the overhead provided by the leakage bins is quite low when you increase the FFT size from 64 to 2048. Well, this shows that we are effectively backhauling the samples within the resources available in the software-defined radio. Well, there are a couple of more challenges before we can actually say we implemented it in the, we implemented sparse SDR in real time. The first challenge is that the data rate of the backhaul is unpredictable. Basically, it means that when there are more signals, we will backhaul more data. And sometimes it might be the case that data rate might spike. For example, at the end of the, on top left, you have a very high data rate. And it might be the case that the backhaul bandwidth available will, may not be able to accommodate this data into it. So we need to have some memory modules as a cushion so that it can store this data and send it when there is bandwidth available. Fortunately, we have memory modules called BRAMs on most of the software-defined radios, and we can use them as FIFOs. The next challenge is that, obviously, we have to implement all this stuff in real time. So the problem with software implementing it on FPGA is that the clock rate of FPGA is limited, and the sampling rate of the ADC is equal to the clock rate of FPGA. And what this means is that we generate a new sample for every clock cycle. And obviously, we need to compute a lot. Like, we need to do FFT windowing and thresholding within a clock cycle. So we do not have any spare clock resources available. So fortunately, there are like pipeline implementations of FFT and multiplication, which kind of operates in a way that you send one sample in, and there is one FFT sample out. So this takes care of that. So until now, I have explained to you how we can implement our proposed algorithms on hardware in existing software-defined radios. Now, to showcase the performance of Sparse SDR, I take two use cases or two case studies. The first one being Universal IoT Gateway. In this example, I use Sparse SDR to decode Bluetooth signals in real time and analyze and decode the bits using Raspberry Pi. Why do we want to use Sparse SDR as an IoT gateway? As you can see, this is an example capture, and as you can see, Sparse SDR only backhauls the bins which are absolutely necessary, and in advertising phase, it takes in the signals only corresponding to the advertising channels, and in the connection phase, it only takes in the signals which are randomly hopping. So the next question is that can the compute of the Sparse SDR be proportional to the activity of the signals? To evaluate this, we increase the advertising rate of the Bluetooth packets and check if the backhaul is proportional to the data rate. And obviously, we can see that the data rate is proportional to the transmissions. And also, we observe that Raspberry Pi divides the load into four CPU cores effectively, and the CPU usage gracefully increases as we increase the packets per second. This proves that Sparse SDR is compute proportional also. Next application, we show how we can use Sparse SDR for cloud SDR application. In this, we capture the spectrum from 50 MHz to 400 MHz and divide it into chunks of 10 MHz and check if we can backhaul the signals in these bands using the residential backhaul. And the y-axis represents the percentage of the percentage of the bandwidth used relative to the existing SDRs. As you can see, most of them are below the residential uplink, and as you can expect, the FM takes a little more than the average residential uplink because it has continuous transmissions. And so we have proved, even though it takes more, it is 20% of the normal software defined radio, so we are good. So future work includes porting it to more platforms, and obviously making cloud SDRs a reality, and also making IoT gateway use case more comprehensive. We are going to enable multiple protocol decoding and also have the transmit side. So to use Sparse SDR, you can go to this link, download the FPGA bin file and the GUNO radio block, put the GUNO radio block in your workflow and start collecting data. Thank you, and I can get any questions.